the creation of our manual, which was really very much of an open source kind of a project about an open source piece of software, Scribus. And here, what I'm talking about here today is a story how this happened. It really was somewhat of an accident, as you'll find out later. Now, the first thing I think it's important to deal with, though, is to tell you that I'm a neurologist, and I know that's kind of unexpected, and the only flip side of that is I went to a medical meeting a few months ago, and we talked to some people there and told them, I'd just written a book. Oh, what's it about? Well, it's about software. And they were like, what? So, you know, these things happen. That's all I can say. This is sort of the abridged history of my life with regard to how we got to writing a manual for this piece of software. Started back here, and you know, not unlike a lot of people in pre-med, I ended up being a chemistry and math student, and part of that was taking computer science. And this was in the days of these IBM punch cards and key punch operators and all that other stuff that was going on. And so then you get lost in the black hole of getting medical training once you get into medical school, and you disappear from society for a while. And finally, then I come out into the real world in Louisville, Kentucky, as much as you can consider Louisville, Kentucky to be the real world. And I would just emphasize to Louis that it's not Louisville, it's Louisville. That's how we pronounce it there. Somewhere after that was around when, you know, Apple started going, Steve Jobs and Woz and all that other stuff. That was my real first computer there, the Apple IIe. I didn't really, wasn't so happy, not to offend anybody, about the Apple business model, so I just kind of moved out of that into an Amiga. And I was fairly happy with that. It was something you could work with. There were lots of stuff about how to do this and that with, and sort of hands-on kinds of things that you could actually do to it instead of a black box. And we all know what happened to Amigas, and somewhere in that process also, I wanted to have a laptop. Well, Amigas never had a laptop, so I had to do something, went to DOS, which was okay until the laptop died. So then we had to go to Windows, and I think 98 was probably, Windows 98 was the first version that I had. And I just decided very quickly I didn't like Windows. It just, I don't know what it was about it. You know, we had the same sort of kind of GUI looking interface, but it just, I didn't like it. And of course, that was in the days of the blue screen of death and all that business. So I realized I can't do this. I got to get out of this. When things go bad, I don't know what to do with it. I used to know what to do back here. So finally, I found out about Red Hat Linux. And as we all know, at that point in time, trying to put Red Hat Linux on a gateway laptop was not an easy thing. It took a lot of researching and hands-on, and I think it probably took me about 2 weeks or so to finally get X running, which is, you know, that's one of those moments of elation when that finally happens. And then finally, you know, we get to where we are here today with Linux, and, you know, once you get on Linux, you sort of tend to get a little bit hooked. So I've just stayed with it ever since, and now I'm mostly using Fedora. So now we're getting closer to where we need to be. Now, this is a famous painting, and this is a depiction of Franz Schmidt creating the allegorical representation of Scribus over here on the left. There were rumors that this is the moment in which Franz met Peter Linnell, but I don't have any data on that. This happened in the background. I happened to bump into an article in Linux Journal about Scribus. Said, oh, well, this sounds interesting. I might add that, you know, back when I was in college, I had a lot of people who were in fine arts. And, you know, back then there was this attitude that, well, you know, either you were in science and you're sort of a science guy, or you were in graphics and art and you were that kind of a person, but I really never saw that dichotomy, and I think the group here is kind of fits in with that, that you don't have to be one or the other. You can kind of be interested in both of these things. So I got interested in Scribus, sorry. You know, even I pronounce it as I thought it was supposed to be pronounced, but this is the pronounced Scribus according to Franz. So that's sort of like the final word as far as I'm concerned. So I thought I'd just very quickly show you a brief representation of how I look at learning about Scribus with using cartoon characters. You start out at this stage where this is the people that send letters to the mail list saying, I've just downloaded the software and I've started up, now what do I do? The Homer stage. Then we get to the Bart stage, where people asking questions like, I don't even know how to answer this, because this person doesn't even know what they're doing. And finally, you get, you know, you read a lot of answers to questions, you start maybe answering a few, you answer a few that are wrong, and somebody else has to correct, but eventually you start learning something about the software and able to actually help people out, and you get to the somewhat philosophical stage, which I call the Donald Rumsfeld stage of knowledge about Scribus, where you can begin to sort of help people, but maybe you're not really helping them, but you know, you feel better about it anyway. Okay, so the next thing is, why would I, as a neurologist, want to use Scribus? Why would that ever come up? Well, that comes up because I do things like this, although not necessarily in this front of this kind of a group. I do talks in front of various kinds of medical people. So to me, that's my probably biggest professional use of Scribus. And just a few examples of selected images from things that I've done. You can see that I have a little bit of an attitude about how I do presentations. I don't do the PowerPoint bullets and all the rest of that stuff. This was on a talk I did for speech therapists about the thalamus. This is a talk I did on inflammatory nerve diseases for a bunch of nurses. And this is the cell attacking the node of Ranvier here. And you can see that now we have little microelectrodes that we can actually find out what's going on inside the body in these disease processes. And finally, I did this one. I submitted this to the hospital administration where I work because, you know, it's been many years that they've been a smoke-free hospital. Well, a couple of years ago, they decided to make it a smoke-free campus so that anyway, on the hospital property, as soon as you set foot on the hospital property, you're not allowed to smoke. So now we have a steady stream of employees who are walking across the street to a park to smoke on a break, and then they come back to the hospital. So I thought, in the interest of public health and safety, that we really need to do something to try to keep the drivers aware of all these people that were smoking, and some of them probably have a hurry going both directions. So that's how I use Scribus. Now we finally get to the book. And in case people have read on our mailing list, and we've had many questions of whether the book actually exists, here it is. And yes, this is not a blank page item. This is the real thing. This is sort of the innocent one-sentence question on the mail list that led to this, believe it or not. You know, this guy was just asking, is there something out there that I can download and print out myself? Of course, we have the wiki, we have the online docs, we have the documentation that comes with the software itself. So some people said, well, I'm riding on the train, I'd like to have something I could read while I'm riding, and that would really help me start to understand the software. And so then in Donald Rumsfeld mode, I immediately answered his question and basically came up with, I would say, a long-winded philosophical blow-off of his question, saying that, well, it just, you know, probably isn't going to happen. And we had several other people chime in on the list that, well, the software is changing too fast. Well, we have all the people working on development. They're all volunteering their time. And, you know, if you want to do it, you're more than welcome to download this stuff from the wiki or wherever you can get it and make a PDF, and that's up to you. Well, then Cedric here, he said, well, hey, maybe this isn't such a bad idea. Maybe we ought to do something, and why don't we set up a task force? And interestingly enough, we did set up a task force. And I played around with it a little bit, and probably what I did irritated enough people in the right way that they said, well, I think I can do a better job than that. And so they got ideas, we had contributions. So it started getting a little bit of a momentum. Now, here's where Christoph comes to the scene. Christoph Schaefer, my co-main author of the book, We had people offering to do this, offering to do that. Here we were jumping ahead with somebody saying that, well, if you get this going, I have things that I can do, the printers and the get this out in a PDF and print it out for if you want. And Christoph, in Christoph mode, was really emphasizing, no, we need to do this in the right way. We need to first of all decide on a table of contents. And until we get the table of contents, we can't move on to start writing this book. Christoph insisted that I put in here a graphic of a cart before a horse, but I told him, look, once you say cart before the horse, you don't need the picture for the audience to tell them that that's what you're talking about. So here we were going. We were starting to do this. Here's the process. Okay, we started with these comments. Am I working on that? On the mail list, we set up kind of an ad hoc place that we didn't really advertise on our big wiki for our software. It got to be a size, and we also got to the point of thinking, well, we don't want it just people just wandering in there and editing it, because a whole lot of people had privileges, or still have privileges, to add material, edit material on our regular wiki. So we moved it to a dedicated wiki. And from that point on, this is really where the book was written, here in our dedicated wiki. And that, of course, involved a whole lot of conversations on Scribus Channel on IRC. And probably the other thing that really helped this out, Christoph, I have never met him. He lives in Germany, but for whatever reason, his life runs on Eastern Standard Time. He is up as late as I'm up, and usually later than I'm up. So we obviously had a whole lot of conversations every evening about where the manual was going. So I thought I'd just pick out some snippets out of the log files of the Scribus channel and just point out, this is, I think, a snapshot of Christoph and his approach to things. And so we had our task force, and at this point he became dubbed the task master. And then finally, we were well into this process, and Louis is reviewing what's going on and seeing that, whoa, this book is really moving fast. It's really taking shape, giving us lots of compliments. And here's where the term maniac. So we became the task force maniacs, Christoph and I, as we began writing this. Now here's the man himself. I know a lot of people, even on the Scribus team, have never met him. I've never met him. I didn't know what he looked like until I got this picture from him. So we had this conversation, and to say that Christoph is a high pressure guy is kind of an understatement. But I would say that do not be fooled by this nice, placid appearance and this smiling face. If this man is coming towards you and going to hand you a job, you either take the job and you do it, or you run the other direction. I struggled to get some information about him. He has a PhD, and he's not a software developer either, but I'm going to try to pronounce this correctly. His PhD is in Kriegsvernufterlingen, which is something about the Dutch military engineers from 1600 to 1800. Currently he's working in some museums in his home city, and he's starting to get more involved with writing about open source software, and that's, I think, the direction he would like things to go. So here we're asking for other people to come in and review our work that we're doing, and trying to just get people a little bit of a sense of that we sort of like him to get on things and get the work done. And of course, when you spend a lot of time on IRC, then you get other things that come in, and you try to answer questions, and I have no idea who this guy was and what he had in mind, but you get, of course, a lot of strange things. And I thought maybe the GIMP people ought to see that they've got people that they can't find somebody to talk to. Now, here's a graph of of what this is. The interesting thing is, which I really didn't find out about this until I was preparing this talk, is that you can go to wikis and find out what various contributors have done. Obviously, I'm just putting the top three people here, myself, Christoph, and Tom Zastrow, and this is a whole lot of editing. You know, we're talking over 2,000 edits in about 5-6 months of time, really. It really wasn't even the 1st of November where this whole concept kind of gelled. So we were doing a lot of editing. This is just watching the counts per month. We actually, interestingly enough, we had thought that we might have a sort of a preliminary release of a chapter last year at LGM, but it really didn't quite come out. And maybe we'll see a little bit about that, about why that was. Now I'm just going to show briefly something about the process. This is two different screenshots, partial screenshots of a couple of different pages. This is as it looks on the wiki. So, you know, we're setting up things, we're putting the graphics in. We knew that the graphics were not the right size. We knew that we were going to put color into our final book, but we really didn't worry about that so much. We just wanted to get something in there as placeholders, and we'd work out the details later. So we started out here. This is working on the wiki. Then the next step, and from here on, this is where Christoph took over. He really did all of this work and the layout for the book. That's the other thing I should add, is that we thought that on a philosophical level, if we're making a book about layout, we should make the book using the software. And so that's what we ended up doing. So this is in OpenOffice. Now, the reason why we use OpenOffice, if you put your text into OpenOffice, you can apply styles, text styles, font styles, in OpenOffice, which will then directly import into Scribus. So that's the advantage of doing that. Now, we're not talking about the layout of the page or the graphics or anything else at this stage, simply just applying the various fonts and font styles. And then this is the final result, at least from a PDF, and of these same pages, following it through the process. So you see that now we've added the graphics, we've added sidebars with information there, we've carefully, you know, made sure that we thought that fonts were okay, that they're legible, that all everything was working out here. And here's where we were. We had our PDF done. And maybe I missed that one. Here we go. This one, I forget one. We had our PDF done. We were ready to get a publisher. We had a publisher lined up. He really, really insisted that we make an index. We hadn't even started an index. I suppose if we had thought we were going to have an index, we would have made it kind of on the fly, or at least had a lot of ideas. So basically, at the time we had the book done, then we wrote an index from scratch. That took a little while. So we've had to work our way through that. So then we have our book. We have a PDF. We have printers. We have a publisher who has made contracts with the printer, both in UK and in the United States. And we're ready to print. And we send them the PDF. And we wait and we wait and we wait a little bit. And they say, your PDF is broken. So we say, well, no, it's not. I mean, we know Scribus. We know the quality it puts out. You look at the file and we can't find anything wrong with it. We can view it perfectly well in Adobe Reader and other kind of viewers. So, you know, we were, at this point, we were just kind of stuck. And unfortunately, at that point, we were also getting people all excited about the book coming out and talking about getting some orders, and I think we were even starting to get some actual real orders, and people were spending money at that point. This is back in December of last year. And then finally, our friend Mr. Desjardins agrees to take a look at this PDF, and he figures out what the problem is. The problem, from his point of view, is that He can put it into his equipment. He can rip it. He can send it through the machine. It makes one copy of the book, and then it's gone. So basically, you have to start the whole process over and over again. So why is that happening? Well, now we go back to the actual PDF, and at which time we find out that the problem is there was some issue with one or more of the fonts, and Christoph ended up outlining them. Well, when you outline a 440-page book, that makes a huge job for the printer. And that is what the equipment didn't like. And Louis even tried it on several different pieces of equipment. So the problem was he was having that issue with the version of Scribus that he was using, which was the 13312 version, and there wasn't any way around it. But fortunately, thanks to our developers, the versions in SVN had fixed that issue, and he was able then to embed the fonts that took care of the problem with the printing equipment, and so at that point we were ready to start printing books. Now, the other thing I should add here about making this, Scribus has a little bit of trouble handling large volumes of text. And when you're talking about a largely textbook of 440 pages, that is so beyond the capabilities of Scribus as far as something that practically is going to work, that what you have to do, and we've told our users many, many times, you have to carve it down. So how do you do that? Well, you have to do chunks of the work, say about 30 pages or so, but it ended up being whatever a couple of chapters might be. Then you make PDFs out of those, and then you take those PDFs and splice them. All this software to do that is out there easily available. So that's really how the PDF. So you can imagine when we're having to undo the whole book that Christoph is having to go back to the original individual PDFs, fix those, and then go to PDFTK to splice them together. So there was a tremendous amount of work that involved. And as many people know that know about the book, we still have people that ordered back in December who haven't got their books, and this is how we've learned about logistics. I think the main thing I would say is just we have a startup publisher who's been kind of in charge of it, and there are various aspects of the process that he wasn't anticipating, nor were we, but certainly we've learned a lot in this to hopefully be able to overcome this in the future. But problem is that Louis is really doing a good part of the printing, at least depending on where it was ordered, and is shipping worldwide. And due to cost issues, we can't send them as quickly to, for example, the EU and certainly Australia as we can to North America. So that's really been a huge delay for a lot of people who, as I say, still don't have their books. Now, finally, the only other thing I would like to say, and a lot of people may actually already know this. You know, what's the advantage of having wiki versus printed? Do you need a printed manual of your book? Well, you know, as we've gone through this, I mean, we sort of tossed it back and forth a lot at the beginning, saying, well, you don't really need this. The wiki's there all the time. The online docs are there all the time. We can just make those better. Well, there are distinct advantages. You know, the way that I look at trying to get information out of a wiki is a little bit like trying to see what's going on when all your view is like the porthole of a ship. You know, you're able to look at one thing at a time, and you can switch that. You can switch that view to something else, but it isn't like you can really hold that. So you may get information from one area, and then you have to remember that as you look on another page, and there's many situations that really doesn't work. Whereas a book, I mean, you have lots of ways of sticking your thumb in here and looking at this and looking at another place and back and forth. It just is a very much a more user-friendly thing as far as a certain kinds of information that you want to do. It's something that also has a natural order to it. It has a flow to it. It has something where you can start at a point and read it through. And that was part of how we designed the book, was for that, so that you could start at the beginning or at some point and read through in some kind of logical fashion to learn the book. Well, the wiki, I'd have to say, isn't set up that way. It's really kind of a hunt and peck method of you trying to decide what you want to learn now. It's an ad hoc kind of thing, whereas the information on the wiki is dependent on somebody putting it in there, and it just sort of pops into somebody's idea that they're going to add a page on this or that. Somebody else might edit it. There's sort of varying quality. The age factor comes in, where information gets dated and never gets updated, and so there are a lot of issues with Wiki. It isn't like it's one single piece of work. It's a work over a very extended period of time. So there's a lot of problems there. So I think that's the informational advantage. Now, as we have set this up, and part of what we wanted to do also, personally, I decided I don't want to have any money from this project, and so anything that would have come to me as an author is going to describe as project. So theoretically, something like this can be a means of funding open source projects. I think that's another handle on this whole thing. Why would you do something like this? Well, first of all, you have to be able to do it. You have to have the personnel, the energy, whatever it takes to do it. Once you do, though, and you can get something like this set up, it is a way of at least generating some kind of funds. Now, you know, a project like Scribus, I would admit, has probably a limited audience, at least at this point. Is it ever going to start grabbing people away from InDesign, from Quark, from other things that are out there that they've been using for a long time? I don't know. But if they do, that could really increase the demand for this book, because certainly commercial operations, they want something like this. They don't want to mess with a wiki. They don't want to try to figure out the software for themselves. So this could be an incentive for them to buy, and when places like that buy, they're likely to buy in quantity. So I think these are all things to consider, I think, for various projects, to consider trying to put the information at one point in time that really tries to contain everything that you know about it, so that you can build on that later and perhaps even get new people interested in your software. And that's pretty much all I'm going to say. Other than that, that we have made arrangements to have copies of the book available here for a price that you will not find anywhere else. That's about all I can say about that. It is a discount from anything that you can find of any other source that will have this book for sale, and that's unique to LGM. That's sort of a thing that we wanted to do for this group here, that for coming and supporting us over the years. So that's it. Any questions?
Is the content of the book licensed under an open content license, or is it?
It is, yes. It's in the back of the book, which you can read in detail. But basically, the license is an open license as far as the content. What you're restricted from is you taking the information and making a book out of it. That's basically how it operates. But will we at some point release the PDF for general distribution? I don't know that yet. We sort of, in the process of this whole printing and shipping thing, ended up sending PDFs to many people who had already purchased the books and were waiting and waiting and waiting. So they had that to kind of convince them that, yes, there really was a book out there. This wasn't really just a sham operation to take their money.
I'm just asking because we have the same problem with the Blender book. The content itself is open content, but not the layout. The layout is done by a publishing firm. And what happened is we put the content itself without formatting, and then the wiki team took it and put it there. So is that going to happen, or is it already happening for the Scribus book, or is the content already on the wiki somewhere, is what I'm asking. Or somewhere online?
Well, technically it's on a wiki. I don't know. We haven't really decided whether to make that generally, accessible or available where that is. The only thing I would say about it is that there were some significant edits from the wiki to the final product, as far as the actual content, and as well as the fact that things got rearranged. And once we got to the point of using OpenOffice, we didn't go back and re-edit the wiki to make the wiki right. The wiki is where it was at that frozen point in time when we decided we were going to move on to the next step of the process. I should add, as far as the process of making a book, one of the things we did here, which is a way of not costing a project a lot of money, is this is a print-on-demand book. In other words, there aren't books out there in bookstores that we had to buy 1,000 copies or more than that, so we didn't have to come up with that money. Basically, theoretically at least, books don't exist until somebody orders them. Now, having said that, we also know that Amazon will have printed and buy up a few quantities at a time, because if you go to Amazon.com, for example, typically you'll find that they'll say, if you order this book today, you can have it by, 2 or 3 days from now. So they typically will have a few copies on hand by the way that they manage their business.
The book effect of threads using threads 133X, right?
The 133X series. I mean,
yes.
Basically everything, when we started this, 133.12 was the current stable. By the time we're in the tail end of it here, right at this point, 133.13 is the current stable, and the book, everything in the book still applies to 133.13 pretty much.
Yes, but we know that a lot of users actually use unstable version, which is currently 135, and amount of changes is really large. So the question is, if you have any schedule to create the next edition that will...
Yes. Well, I wouldn't say schedule. We have plans to move on to the next version, because as you say, a lot of the appearance features of Scribus have changed from current stable to our current developmental. The problem we have as far as getting into that work is they're still not fully hashed out. So until we have all that hashed out, we're kind of holding off on getting started on the next edition. I would say probably to a large extent, the changes of the next edition will involve sort of a reworking of all the screenshots, because there's so many screenshots that will be very different. And aside from that, just adding the things that developmental versions have that stable doesn't, things like render frames, things that like working with Podofo and some of this other stuff that's just not a part of 133X series. So that's the things that will be added. I think the content is probably going to be about the same, although Christoph informs me that the size is sort of going to have to increase because of all these added features. I don't know how we're going to manage that, because we get into, one of the things you find out here is we started out, we thought this was going to be a 300-page book, and we were going to really work to limit it to a 300-page book. Well, with his messages on the email list or whatever to me saying, oh, I've just thought of something, we need to add this, oh, we need to add that. And one of the things it has here that, you could argue, well, maybe we didn't need things like the DTP toolbox. We didn't need to explain about fonts. We didn't need to explain about various kinds of file formats for graphics. But we have, for our experience, on the mail list, indicates that there are so many people out there using this that have no idea what you talk about when you start talking about fonts and typography and bitmap file formats and all that other stuff and color management. If you don't put that in there, I think you're doing a new user a little bit of a disservice. Now, the experienced people, maybe even some of them, would like to have a reference for some of this information, because otherwise they might have to try to pull it in from scattered areas to understand this. So I think it almost has to be in there. One more, maybe. Oh.
So do you have already any feedback how sales are doing?
Well, I know that through our publisher's website, we've sold something in excess of 300 copies, probably close to 400, if not more than that by now. I don't have any knowledge. He may have a knowledge of how many we've sold through, say, Amazon or other sites, but that's, you know, just tactile. I don't know that that's huge numbers. We probably have had the bulk at the publisher's site, but you know, that's probably likely to shift. I'm not sure. So, you know, I think that's an index of the esoteric crowd you're talking about using this software, because you're not only picking out these people that would be interested in this kind of thing. We're a little bit, you know, the commercial people are doing the commercial software, so, you know, they may be sort of looking at Scribus, but probably not going to use it, and probably therefore not going to buy the book. But as I say, that may change. I mean, it's one of those things that can change very rapidly, you know, and maybe the economy is one of the things that will sort of push it in that direction. I don't know. They're trying to record this on the.
We need the mic because we're recording.
Okay. Well, you could rather record me from the other end of the room. As far as the book size goes and these extra topics, my suggestion would be that you keep the book reasonably small with all the core topics, but in a sense, you treat these additional chapters that would make it bulky as if they were appendices, and then you put those on the web for free.
Yeah,
and
that's an option.
These extra chapters can serve as a teaser for buying the book. Except
yeah.
they're not the first chapter that's a
right.
teaser. They're actually the last chapter that's
yeah.
a teaser. So
well, you know, the size, you know, what you find out when you get into the real world of actually making stuff that you take yourself to a printer to go out there and try to get sold is that you start running into a cost barrier. Not a literal cost barrier to us, but a cost barrier to whoever's going to buy it. You know, I think we kind of pushed it to the limit now. The list price in the U.S. is $50, which is on the high end of a software manual kind of a book. And that started out based on the British pound at 30 pounds. Now the exchange rates have been such that 30 pounds now in exchange is less than that 50 U.S. dollars, but basically the U.S. dollar price is sort of carved on the back of the book. So that is a thing we're going to have to limit. We may want to make it bigger, but we may have to do something like what you're saying, just so the price doesn't get crazy.
I just want to add that I agree completely with that idea of having a few chapters on the web, and so trim down the book a little bit.
Right.
If we're going to increase or to right. make another edition or things like that.
And we probably want to try to find a way to encourage somebody who may have already bought this edition to buy the second one. You know, they don't necessarily want to buy all that other stuff again. They already have it once, and yes, there may be changes in web links or something that are this in regard to DTP or whatever, but you know, that doesn't necessarily mean they want to pay for it in a printed book.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Okay.